Welcome students to NIOS. I am Aparajita and today I am going to teach you about post-Mauryan art. Mauryan art may be said to exhibit three main phases. The first phase was the continuation of the pre-Mauryan tradition, which is found in some instances to the representation of Vedic deities. The most significant examples are the reliefs of the Surya, the Indra at the Bhaja caves. The second phase of the court art of Ashoka, typically found in the monolithic columns on which his edicts are inscribed, and the third phase was the beginning of brick and stone architecture, as in the case of original stupa at Sanchi. The small monolithic rail at Sanchi and the Lomash Rishi cave in the Barabar hills, with its ornamental facade reproducing the forms of wooden structure. The contribution of Shunga. After the death of Ashoka, the Mauryan Empire broke to pieces. After about half a century, the Shunga came to govern the part of northern India. They took over the Mauryan Empire. However, the style of architecture, decoration and sculpture continued to about the close of first century of Christian era, forming a definite period in the history of Indian art. Contribution of the Shunga period. The period saw a flowering of the visual arts, including small terracotta images, large stone sculptures and architectural monuments such as the Chaitya Hall at Bhaja, the stupa at Bharut and the renowned great stupa at Sanchi. Learners, we know that under Shunga patronage, the core of the great stupa, thought to date from the era of the Mauryan Emperor Ashoka, that is 273 to 233 BC, was enlarged to its present diameter of 120 feet, covered with a stone casing, topped with a balcony and umbrella, and encircled with a stone railing. Four famous gateways, each about 35 feet high, were carved during the first half of the first century AD. Decorated with images of auspicious fertility spirits known as Yakshas and Yakshis, the gateways also feature narratives depicting moments from the past lives of the final existence of Siddhartha Gautama, the founder of Buddhism. Motifs such as wheels, thrones and footprints are used under the patronage of the Indo-Greek, Indo-Scythian and Kushan kings. Now emerge a distinct style of sculpture, popularly known as Greco-Roman, Buddhist or Gandhara art and Mathura art. To symbolize the Buddha, who is not represented in human form until later, we know that during Ashokan period or the Mahayana or Hinayana period, Buddha was not represented in his human form. He was represented by various auspicious symbols which were associated with him. Now we will discuss about the Gandhara art. Gandhara art was a combination of Hellenistic, West Asiatic and native elements. Greek and Roman techniques modified according to Indian requirements were employed in fashioning the Gandhara sculpture, which truly represents Indian culture in a Western garb. So we note that Gandhara art was a combination of Greek and Roman techniques with Indian sentiments. Its area extended from Takshila in India to the Swat Valley in Pakistan and northwards to areas in Afghanistan as well. The Gandhara sculptures made images of Lord Buddha in the Greco-Roman style. The images of Buddha resembled Greek god Apollo. It gave more stress to the bodily features and external beauty. In the Mathura school of art, we see pure indigenous style. Mathura art developed during post-Maurya period, mainly during Shunga period, and reached its peak during the Gupta period, that is AD 325 to 600. The traditional center, Mathura, remained the main art production site, whereas Kausambi, Sarnath also emerged as important centers of art production. Spotted red sandstone has been used in this school. Themes in the Mathura art vary from Buddhist to Brahminical to sometimes secular. More stress was given to the inner beauty and facial emotions rather than bodily gesture. So this is a very important distinguishing factor between the Gandhara and Mathura art. Gandhara art focused mainly on physical charm because it was influenced heavily by the Greek and Roman cultures. And sometimes Buddha, as mentioned earlier, that Buddha almost looked like Greek god Apollo. But at the same time, the parallel school, the Mathura school, we find that the influences are very much Indian, and the beauty of the inner self and emotions are given more importance over bodily gesture. Under the Mathura art, images of Vishnu, Shiva, Buddha, Yaksha and Yakshinis. Yaksha and Yakshinis, we know they are superhuman deities or figures which were very popular since the Mauryan time. In Mathura art, we find, apart from Vishnu, Shiva and Buddha images, Yaksha and Yakshinis. Shaivite and Vaishnavite deities were also found. Shaivite means the deities related to Shiva cult, and Vaishnavite means the deities related to Vishnu. In these cultures, Buddha was depicted as human, and the main theme was Buddha and Bodhisattvas. Both sitting and standing posture of Buddha statues were carved out in Mathura school. The art of Mathura also featured some sexual imagery. The characteristic of the idol of Buddha are Buddha sitting under a Bodhi tree. Bodhi tree, as we all know, is the tree under which Buddha attained his enlightenment. So Buddha sitting under a Bodhi tree is very, very popular figure or sculpture in Mauryan art. Buddha has the posture of Abhaya Mudra. His right hand is in Abhaya posture. Dharma Chakra and Tri Ratna chiseled in palms and the bottom of the feet. Except for one lock, the entire head is shaven. Buddha, depicted in Gandhara art, is shown making four types of hand gestures. Learners, we must be very aware that hand gestures are very, very important while making of the sculptures, because different hand gestures denote different kind of expressions and different kind of symbolic values. And this is a remarkable feature in this art. Both Mathura and Gandhara, we see Buddha with many, many special features and hand gestures which are very, very typical of Gandhara and Mathura art. Mathura school of art is purely indigenous style. Learners, we have already discussed this, that Mathura school of art shows totally indigenous characteristics. That means it is totally Indian in its character. Mathura art developed during post-Mauryan period, mainly during the Shunga period, and reached its peak during the Gupta period. So Mathura art also has a long duration, whereas Gandhara art is mainly about 1st century AD, we find the blossoming of Gandhara art. The traditional center, Mathura, remained the main art production site, whereas Sarnath and Kausambi also emerge as important centers of art production. Spotted red sandstones has been used in these schools. Themes in the Mathura art vary from Buddhist to Brahminical to sometimes secular. More stress was given to the inner beauty and facial emotion rather than bodily gesture. Under Mathura art, images of Vishnu, Shiva, Yaksha, Yakshinis, Shaivite and Vaishnavite deities were found. In the sculptures, Buddha was depicted as human, and the main theme was Buddha and Bodhisattvas, both sitting and standing posture. Now we will come to Amaravati school of art. The Amaravati school of art, mainly Amaravati in South India, southern part of India, it developed. School of art evolved during Satvahana period. The school of art developed at Amaravati on the banks of Krishna River in modern Andhra Pradesh. The school of art had great influence on art in Sri Lanka and Southeast Asia, as products from here were carried to those countries. During those time also, trade was very popular between India and its neighbors, and many of those images and styles were carried from one country to another, which is evident in the influences the art and architecture of this period reflect. It is completely indigenous in nature. Amaravati art is very, very indigenous. Again, like the Mathura school we had mentioned earlier, Amaravati art is very Indian in its nature. Lord Buddha is depicted in the form of swastika mark. Swastika mark, as we all must be knowing, is a very auspicious mark of Hindus, which is even used today. This has been carved out on the cushion seat over a throne that is situated under the Bodhi tree. They used white sandstone to construct the images. At a later stage, the Amaravati school depicted Buddha in the human form. The figures of Amaravati have slim features and are represented in difficult poses and curves. With Amaravati, we come to the close of older phase of Indian artistic tradition. In the period now beginning, we witness the blossoming out of an aesthetic consciousness in which an established tradition find its most supreme expression. This period, as we all know, has been described as the golden age of Guptas. Learners, it is very, very crucial and important to know about the Gupta phase in Indian art, because the Guptas, with their wealth and power, provided an atmosphere for a brilliant aspect of Indian genius in all the field of human activities, be it art, be it architecture, be it literature, music, especially art and literature, which attained utmost limit of refinement. Very active center of Buddhist culture was at Sarnath. Earlier, we had seen that since Ashokan times, Sarnath was a very, very crucial center for Buddhist activities and development of many, many structures. Sarnath, where both standing and seated Buddha types were developed. One of the noblest and finest creation of Gupta culture is high relief statue of Buddha, which we find in the ruins of Sarnath, carved in sandstone. It shows Buddha giving his first sermon, seated in a pedestal, and below the pedestal, two groups of kneeling monks are seen worshipping the wheel of law. The wheel of law, as we have already discussed in the Mauryan period, is very, very significant because it symbolizes the enlightening wisdom of Buddha. It represents the expression of soul, ideal beauty of form, and exquisitely carved halo are its special attraction. So, discussing about the Sarnath Buddha, it is very, very prominent because it represents a facial, beautiful facial expression and the beautiful soul also, which is reflected in the Buddha face. Ideal beauty of form as well. They are very minimalistic, less decorated, but very beautiful, very linear, very poetic, and exquisitely carved halo are also special attraction of this Sarnath Buddha. The glory of the Gupta age proper, that is 350 to almost 650 Christian era, had been made permanent through the visible creations of its art. Different forms of art, example, sculpture, painting, and terracotta, attained a maturity, balance, and naturalness of expression that have ever been, that has excelled any form, previous form of Indian art, and still remains the most beautiful art India has ever produced. Some of our most delicately carved and beautiful monuments representing the very heart of India's artistic achievement, among which the immortal Ajanta murals take precedence, continue the cultural heritage of the Gupta period. Thank you.